Let us start with the simplest possible case. A one-dimensional continuous piecewise smooth map. And let's study what kind of dynamics it will show. And you see that even in this very, very simple case, it exhibits dynamics that are not observed in smooth systems. So this function f, x and mu, mu is a parameter, is a piecewise smooth continuous map, is f, x, mu is continuous, and it is smooth in each of the regions Ra and Rb, but its derivative is discontinuous at the border, xb. So when these two conditions are satisfied, we say that it is a piecewise smooth continuous map. And it is piecewise monotonous if the derivative of the function can change only at the border. So let the first map be given by one function when x is smaller than the border value, another function when the x is bigger than the border value. So we can draw schematically the map like this, right? So it is a smooth function, but at this point it is non-smooth. So in general, it will be called a piecewise smooth map. And at this point, it is continuous. Now, as you change a parameter, normally there will be a fixed point, and that fixed point will move, will change, its position will change, and at some critical value, this fixed point may collide with this border. When that happens, then there is a sudden change in the slope at the fixed point, so the stability status of the fixed point changes, and the resulting bifurcational phenomena are called the border collision bifurcations, right? So we are trying to study that. But since what we are trying to study are local to this region, that means when it hits the border, so the whole thing is local to this region, so we are essentially trying to study local bifurcations. If it is local bifurcation, then it can be studied by a piecewise linear approximation of this whole piecewise smooth map. That will be far simpler to study. So what is the standard procedure is to obtain a piecewise linear normal form. It is called the border collision normal form. In the 1D system, it is nothing but the tent map, right? So how to do that? All we need to do, basically we are doing this. From here, we are obtaining this. In addition, we have to get the origin to this point so that the map is further simplified. So we now do a change of coordinate. This will get the origin to the border, and then yes. The simplest possible map in which a period doubling is observed, that is called the normal form for period doubling. Similarly, simplest possible form in which a saddle-knot bifurcation is observed is called the normal form for the saddle-knot bifurcation. Similarly, the simplest form in which a border collision is observed is the normal form for the border collision bifurcation. Okay, so that is what we are trying to observe, trying to obtain. So the border now goes to x bar equal to 0, and then the map is given by this. And then we expand to the first order by obtaining these partial derivatives. And there will be something of the higher order, but in the first order approximation, it would be a times x plus some mu times this derivative with respect to mu, b times x plus another the parameter times the derivative of the function with respect to mu. And if you have to have the map as continuous, then that will demand that VA is equal to VB, if we recall VA and VB by this. So ultimately, through this procedure, you obtain the simple possible map. It is nothing but the tent map. There are three parameters, A, B, and mu. And mu has a special place here, in the sense that as mu is varied from a negative value to a positive value, the map actually moves up, right? Because mu is just additive term, moves up. And as it moves up, the border position will at some point of time collide with the fixed point will collide with the border, and that happens at mu is equal to zero. So this is how the whole thing is written. So it will be one kind of behavior for mu less than zero, another kind of behavior for mu greater than zero. And we are trying to figure out what can happen. Again, the same procedure. We first find the fixed points. For the left-hand side of the map, there will be a fixed point. I'll call it XL star, which will be given by this. In the right-hand side of the map, there will be another fixed point. Now, for this fixed point to exist, this value must be negative because it is obtained with the negative side of the map, right? And in order for this value to be to exist, this fixed point to exist, these values should be positive. Now, it may so happen that this value actually comes out to be a positive number. In that case, that fixed point does not exist. So L star does not exist, or if this one comes out to be negative, it does not exist, but we'll call it as a virtual fixed point, right? Virtual in the sense that it actually does not exist, but you'll later see that even it does not exist, it exerts its influence on the dynamics of the system. We'll see that. So let us start. First, simplest case. The period 1 to period 1, nothing happens in the system when the slopes are less than 1. So for mu less than 0, the graph of the map is like this. So you have a fixed point here. For mu greater than 0, the graph of the point is like that. You have a fixed point here. So as mu changes, it goes up. So it is stable because the slope is less than 1. Stable because the slope is less than 1, so 1 to 1. So there is nothing special here. Practically nothing happens. No bifurcation, you can say. If in the both the sides the slopes are bigger than 1, then also nothing happens. Because in neither case, any attractor exists. So this is also not an interesting situation. We'll come to the interesting situation now. Suppose in this side, the slope is bigger than 1, and in this side, it is smaller than 1, then when mu is less than 0, there is no fixed point. Can you see that? And when mu is bigger than 0, then two fixed points appear. This one is unstable. This one is stable. It is similar to a saddle node bifurcation. You can see that. So this one will be stable. So it will appear as if from a no fixed point situation, suddenly a period 1 orbit has appeared. That's also nothing very, very special. But then, it is possible that if this slope is also less than, less than minus 1, then there is a possibility that it will lead to no fixed point to chaos. Let us look at the picture. This one is an unstable fixed point. This one is another unstable fixed point. And therefore, any initial condition to this side will actually go to infinity, minus infinity. Any initial condition to that side will be thrown to that side. Okay? And if it is around this, it will again be thrown to. Therefore, there will be a what is known as a trapping region. Since both the sides have slope bigger than 1, nothing is stable. So it is contained within a trapping region, but nothing is stable. So the result is that a chaotic orbit is born. Born out of what? Nothing. Because so long as it was here, there was no fixed point, and therefore there was no periodic orbit. So it is not that you are used to seeing a periodic orbit developing after some time chaotic behavior, but here it is a chaotic behavior developing out of nothing. There's no fixed point, no periodic orbit, sudden chaos develops. By the way, these things happen. It's not that these are only mathematical constructs. These things actually happen in even engineering systems. Now you might notice that if here is a very critical point, the border, right? The border maps to this point here, and therefore it goes off and then it continues. What is the basin of attraction of that attractor? Is L star. Why? Because anything beyond L star goes away, anything to this side of the L star goes this side. And how big is the attractor? What is the expanse of the attractor? It is this point, right? So this way you can work out in every case what is the attractor size as well as what is the basin of attraction of the attractor. What will happen if mu increases such that this point maps to this side? The possibility exists, right? As mu is increased, it goes up, and at some point in that condition will pertain that it will come to this side. So this will again go to zero, go to infinity, which means that the chaotic attractor at that point loses stability. So then it will become an unstable chaotic behavior. And it is a trivial exercise to actually work out the condition, and the condition is this, that if you have this condition, then you have the chaotic orbit, otherwise no. And then if this condition is violated, then you have no fixed point to no attractor, but there's an unstable chaotic behavior. What is the character of this unstable chaotic behavior? What does it mean? It means that if you start from a point inside that region, it will go on iterating for a long time, and suddenly as you fall here, it will go away. So it will show a very long chaotic transient before the instability is visible. That is the character of an unstable chaotic behavior. So in this case, there is a direct transition to either a chaotic attractor from nothing, from no fixed point, or from no fixed point to a unstable chaotic orbit. Now let's come to the situation which is called border crossing bifurcation, where one fixed point crosses the border and becomes something else. And this happens when the A side, A is the slope of this side, B is the slope of that side, A is smaller than 1, and B is smaller than minus 1, like this. Then what happens? Then, as you change the parameter mu from negative value to a positive value, here there is a stable behavior. Why? Because its slope is less than 1. But when it comes here, it is unstable behavior. So a stable fixed point becomes unstable fixed point. So far, so good. But what happens? Well, when it becomes unstable, the first thing that you should look for is that does a period 2 orbit exist? So in order to work out whether or not a period 2 orbit exists, you first start with this was the map in the left-hand side, and this was the map in the right-hand side. So if write xn plus 2 is b xn plus n mu, and then plug in this, so you get a equation, you solve it, you get the position of the fixed point in the negative side, and that one maps to this point, so you get the 2 points of this. Now, if this period 2 orbit is to exist, then this value must be negative and this value must be positive. Because this was in the negative side, this was in the positive side. If these conditions are satisfied, the period 2 orbit exists. And then you see a normal period doubling. Period 1 becomes period 2. Like this. But there is a notice, a difference between the usual period doubling that you have come across and this period doubling, non-smooth period doubling. In a usual period doubling, the period 2 orbit goes up orthogonally from the original orbit. While in this case, it goes at an acute angle. So this is what will be observed in this case. It is the typical period doubling case caused by border collision. Now, notice that there is a denominator 1 minus AB here, right? Now, there are two possibilities. This value AB might be bigger than one or smaller than one? Accordingly, there are two possibilities that will exist. In the first case, it will be a normal period doubling, all right. But in the second case, the period 2 orbit will exist in the same side as the or mu mu negative side. So it will be like this. So there are two possibilities in this case. One is where you have a normal period doubling with an acute angle. But in the other case, you have, if the fixed point was coming for mu negative, it became unstable. But the period 2 behavior existed and was unstable in the same side, negative side. What is it called? It is called a subcritical period doubling. This is called a supercritical period doubling. This is called a subcritical period doubling. Both happen under two different conditions, separated by AB is equal to 1. In order for this angle to be 90 degree, this map has to be smooth. And depending on the degree of non-smoothness, this angle, this will have an angle. Okay. It's not a fixed angle. It can be any angle, but will not be 90 degrees. That's it. In order for it to be 90 degrees, it has to be smooth. And this is one of the things that is distinctive, that there are many situations where in experimental situations, you observe an experimental bifurcation diagram and you notice that it has an angle like this. And then you know it is caused by a non-smooth system. Yes. Explanation is that the distance between this and that varies. Where is the position? Here. The locations are this. So as mu increases, this distance increases, right? And you'll see that angle can be easily calculated from the position of the original fixed point and these two fixed points. You can do a bit of algebra to calculate it. And that gives the angle. So it can be calculated. All I'm saying is that it always comes out to be an acute angle. That's it. So there are two possibilities, as I showed, that these are the two possibilities. Now there is another possibility that if in this side the slope is much larger, then this period 2 orbit may also become unstable, because in order for the period 2 orbit to be stable, the A times B, two slopes, this product has to be less than 1. If the product is bigger than 1, then it becomes unstable. So when it becomes unstable, then a higher periodic orbit can be stable. A higher periodic orbit, for example, here I have shown one iteration, another iteration, and third iteration comes back. So it's a period 3 orbit with 2 points to the left and 1 point to the right. LLR orbit, left, left, right orbit. And in order for that orbit to be stable, AAB has to be less than 1. When that also changes, so another period 4 orbit can become stable, and so on and so forth. So in this case, you'd see a bifurcation diagram something like this. Period 1, 2. You never see this in a smooth system. Never. Period 1 can only lead to period 2, but you'll never see a period 1 to period 3 or period 4 directly, or period 5, period 9. It's not possible. But in a simple tent map, it's possible. Skew tent map, as you said. And if you calculate, it can be calculated analytically. If you calculate the regions of occurrence of each periodic orbit, as you vary the A and B, sorry, alpha, L, alpha are written, but it's basically A and B. Then you find that there is a range in which the period 2 orbit is stable, a range like this. there is a range in which the period 3 orbit is stable, there is a range in which a period 4 orbit is stable, there is a range in which a period 5 orbit is stable, and so on and so forth. Notice now, suppose you have kept everything fixed and you are only varying A. You can see a bifurcation diagram. Can you anticipate what kind of bifurcation diagram will show? It will show that here it is a period 2 orbit that gives rise to a period 3 orbit that gives rise to a period 4 orbit. It is a period adding cascade. Okay. Not only that, in between these white regions, in this part, no orbit is stable really. But still, a trapping region exists, which means it will be chaotic. So each periodic window is interspersed by chaotic windows. Okay. So this is something, again, peculiar to a non-smooth system, does not happen in smooth systems. Yes. All these have been observed in physical systems. And these are only offering explanation of why these are observed. Period adding cascade is a very common thing. But I must sound a word of caution. Period adding cascade is not caused by this mechanism only. There are other mechanisms of creation of period adding cascades also. But this is one mechanism. This is a period, this is a first order system, one dimensional system. No, in a one dimensional system, you cannot have quasi periodic orbit. In order to, for a quasi periodic orbit, a quasi periodic orbit is cannot happen in continuous time in less than three dimensions because it has to be a torus. There's a Poincare section, you get 2D. So a quasi periodic orbit cannot happen in one dimensional system. One D smooth map
is a logistic map. What do you mean? You do get chaotic orbit.
Logistic map. A smooth map. You do get chaotic orbit. Yeah. Yes. So where? Yeah. Okay. No. Which system? Is in smooth system this will not happen? Which system did I show? Period doubling cascade is fine. Period doubling cascade is fine. From 1 to 2 to 4 to 8 to 16 to 32, that is fine. Okay. But here, you are having 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 to 6. This is something that is not observed in. And interspersed by chaotic behaviors, windows of chaos. So, to give a panoramic view of what happens, this is the A axis, this is the B axis in the parameter space. And we have seen that when both A and B are less than 1, then it is inside this box. And you see that it will be just a period 1 to period 1 behavior. If it is these two, then it is just a unstable to unstable, nothing really interesting. These are the region A. Region B is the one in which a saddle node kind of situation happens, but your smooth concept of a saddle node has to be abandoned here because it can be saddle. It is only this part where you have a saddle node bifurcation like this, but in this part it will be a saddle. Two saddles are created at the border collision, and when that happens, it can directly lead to a chaotic orbit, or it can lead to an unstable chaotic orbit in this part. And this is the dividing line, as I said, This is the condition for that chaos. The C part, this is a line of symmetry in the whole thing. So whatever happens in this part when mu is varied from a negative value to a positive value, same thing happens here from a new mu varies from positive value to a negative value. So it suffices to study only one half. So in this part, it is the third type, border crossing bifurcation. In this part, you will see a period 2 behavior. In this part, you will see a subcritical period doubling. And in this part, you saw all those high periodic orbits as well as chaotic behavior. So this kind of behavior will be in this part. This kind of behavior will also be in this part. So a direct transition from a periodic orbit to a chaotic orbit happens in this part. And the equations are well known, can be derived by hand. All right. Up to this, if there is any question, please ask. All these behaviors that I've talked about are observed. You'd notice that out of this, there are some which are rather dangerous. For example, the subcritical period doubling is a bad situation because a stable periodic orbit was there. Suddenly, it becomes unstable and nothing remains stable after that. That's undesirable. Or if you are varying the parameter in this direction and you have some stable behavior, suddenly there's no fixed point. So, yeah. No, in this case, there is no hysteresis. In this case, there is no hysteresis because hysteresis would happen if the behavior were different this way or that. That normally happens if there are coexisting attractors. So it gets attached to one attractor while going this way. While coming that way, it gets attached to other attractor. Here, there's no two attractors, just one attractor. Therefore, hysteresis cannot happen. There. Thank you. One part. So after the thank you comes the other part. Now I'll come to discontinuous maps. So far I was considering continuous maps. But now we will come to discontinuous maps, 1D. Today I'll confine myself to 1D situations only. And tomorrow I'll talk about two-dimensional Manhauer. If you have a physical system, you try to obtain the map. Now, if the original system is 1D, and it has a external periodic input, that means non-autonomous, then the map will be 1D. If it is a two-dimensional system but autonomous, trace a Poincaré section, it will give rise to a one-dimensional map. And if it satisfies the condition that it is a switching system, then it will always be a piecewise smooth map. So under these conditions, it will give rise to a piecewise smooth 1D map. Okay. And as I've shown that if the final condition for one type is, continuously changes to the condition of the other type, then the map will be continuous. But if there is a situation, that means if there is a border, if I take a point here and another point here, this point maps here and this point also maps very close, then you know that the border line is continuous. But if there is a border such that you take a point, you take another point here, this point maps here, this point maps here, you know that the border is discontinuous. And these kind of situations often happen in physical systems. There are very, very many. No. You don't need to go into impacts. Even converters. Converters can lead to this. Those who study electronics know that one very common means of conversion from analog to digital domain is the sigma delta modulator. And sigma delta modulator gives rise to a discontinuous map. Similarly, there are many. many situations. So in this case, so far we had only this much. All we do now is to add another term L. This L is the length of discontinuity. L is the length of discontinuity. So in this case also, the space is divided into two halves, L and R, and the L is the length of discontinuity, and the fixed points are given by this. Earlier when we did it, L was zero, so it was only this much. Now L is added here. But this tells you something. It tells you that they do not collide. X, L star and XR star do not collide with the border at the same time. This one collides with the border at mu is equal to zero. Look at this. Okay. But this one collides with the border at mu is equal to minus L. Right? So as mu varies, there should be two border collisions. One at mu is equal to zero, another at mu is equal to minus L. Earlier case, there was one border collision. We were investigating what is the result of that border collision. But now, there would be two border collisions for a single map as mu is varied. There are a few noticeable features of a discontinuous map. Firstly, notice that the sign of the border, the sign of the discontinuity is very important. Let me illustrate. Here the sign of the discontinuity is positive, right? It's positive discontinuity. Here it's negative discontinuity. Same values of the slopes. Notice. But in this case, this is stable. Then these two are stable. Then this is stable. So behavior is that first a stable period one behavior goes to period two behavior, again comes to period one behavior. In this case, a stable behavior, but now here, there's no fixed point. Right? There is no fixed point, and here there is again a fixed point. So in between something happens. These two are apparently similar, but this is very, very dissimilar. Because now you notice that no fixed point exists, but the orbit cannot escape either. Because in this side the slope is less than one, in this side the slope is also less than one. So the orbit cannot escape, no fixed point exists. So what will happen then? We'll come to that. All I'm trying to point out now is that there is a very wide difference between a positive discontinuity and the negative discontinuity. In the last case of the continuous map, we had a line of discontinuity. Here also there is a line of symmetry. Here also there is a line of symmetry. So it suffices to study only half of the parameter space. Notice another difference. Suppose you have these two maps, this map and this map, are more or less similar. Only thing is that this is a discontinuous map and this is a smooth continuous map. You notice that as you move it, these two points will come close to each other. At some point, they will collide and then disappear. This is what? A saddle node bifurcation. Okay. Seen the opposite way, no fixed point here, collides. It's a tangent, and then a saddle and a node and a saddle appears. In this situation, A and B both are stable. And what is the basin boundary? Let's see. So the fixed point that sits in the middle, the saddle, is also the basin boundary. Right? Now notice what happens in the discontinuous case. This is stable, similar. But this is not intersected, therefore there is nothing like that. In this case, both are stable, like this. And then this is stable. Now when this both are stable, what is the basin boundary? This point is not there. What is the basin boundary? The discontinuity itself is the basin boundary. Because any initial condition this side will come to this, any initial condition that side will come to that. So the discontinuity itself can act as a basin boundary. Boundary of the basin of attraction, something that doesn't happen in a smooth system. These are some specialties of such systems. So let us now consider the different cases
the way we handled the one-dimensional continuous map as comprising of different cases. Here also we'll talk about different cases. But now, I can keep on describing each case. But I would ask you to understand the logic, how we derive various things. So let us see a situation where A and B both are smaller than 1. Here is a stable, here is stable, but here there is a gap. No fixed point exists. Both the sides are having slope less than 1. Therefore, it cannot escape. From this side, it will be thrown towards that. From this side, it will be thrown towards this. And there will be no escape. In that case, what will be the logic? You first look for the existence of a period 2 orbit. If it does not exist, then you look for the period 3 orbit, and so on and so forth. So in this case also, you can work out in the same way by substituting the, obtaining the second iterate of the map and equating to xn plus 2 is equal to xn. You get the position, and you can get the position like this. This algebra is trivial. The concept is important, so I'm asking you to understand the concept mainly. So this is the value of the one that sits in the left-hand side, and this is the value that sits in the right-hand side. And this period 2 orbit will exist so long as this is negative and this is positive. Simple logic. So there will be a parameter range where the period 2 orbit will exist. Okay? So what will actually be observed? Initially, as mu is varied, initially there will be a period 1 orbit to a period 2 orbit to a period 1 orbit. Good. But then there will be some conditions under which this will be violated. When that happens, you have to look at the period 3 orbit. Now the period 3 orbit can be of two types, LLR or LRR, two possibilities. Okay. So you can, here also you can obtain the condition of existence of each, and it will exist so long as this is negative and this is positive. By the way, why not the other one? Simple. If there are two points in the left, this one, and this one, then unless this one is already in the left-hand side, this one is the first one that can hit the border. Therefore, there's no point in considering this one. This one has to be negative, and that one has to be positive, right? So therefore, there are actually two conditions that have to be satisfied in order for this particular orbit to exist. Similarly, LLR orbit will have two conditions. So the period 3 orbit will exist in two regions of the parameter space. Okay? We have seen that the period 2 orbit will exist in one region of the parameter space, period 3 orbit will exist in two regions of the parameter space, and so on and so forth. And the higher periodic orbits will occur in that kind of larger number of regions. So the orbits, the bifurcation diagram looks like this. Now this is, again, even though that from your perspective, the kind of bifurcation diagram you have seen so far, this might look peculiar, but this is also very, very common. I mean, I have seen in very many different physical situations. Period one region of period 2, two regions of period 3, and higher periodicities. Okay. We'll have more to say about this kind of bifurcation diagrams, because this is very interesting mathematically. It's very interesting physically also, because it happens. So we'll have more to say about these kind of situations. But why this happens, that I've just explained. Okay. Let's continue. Let's take the condition that A is smaller than 1 and B is bigger than 1. What will happen? So long as this condition is satisfied, this is stable. So long as this condition is satisfied, this still remains stable. But when this condition happens, it has gone up and no fixed point. So
a period, one fixed point suddenly disappears. That's all that happens. If the discontinuity is negative, then it's a little more interesting. This is stable behavior, this is unstable. When this condition is there, then this is does not have any fixed point here. There's a fixed point here which is unstable, and there's no fixed point. But in this case, what will happen? Can you see? Can you now argue that this is going to happen in this case? One side has slope less than 1, the other side has slope bigger than 1. Will there be an attractor? This is unstable. Will there be any attractor? Yes, because any initial condition here in this part will be thrown to the left-hand side, and the left-hand side slope is less than 1, so it will be thrown to the right-hand side, so there will be a trapping region. There can be a trapping region. Okay? But this point, this discontinuity point is definitely included in the attractor. And if this point maps, to the upper side of this fixed point, then anything here will go out. Therefore, that will be a condition when the trapping region disappears. So trapping region exists so long as this point maps to lower than the R star, and from that you can obtain the condition. So the logic is more important than actually being able to obtain the condition, because once you understand the logic, the rest is too trivial to really worry about. So in this case, notice that when I say orbits may appear, I didn't say whether periodic or chaotic. If the product of these two slopes is less than 1, AB is less than 1, then the period 2 orbit may be stable. Or is period 3 orbit may be stable, or if period 4 orbit may be stable, or nothing may be stable. If the two product is bigger than 1, nothing may be stable. So the periodic orbits may be there, chaotic orbit may also be there, as mu is varied. And at some very, very specific value, it disappears. That's what I just argued, why. Okay. Let's now come to the situation where this slope is less than 1, and this slope is also less than 1, but negative. This is stable, both are stable, this is stable. Too simple. No problem. In this case, this is stable, but again the similar situation occurs. There's a range in which there will be bounded orbits, but chaos cannot occur. Why? Because both the slopes are less than 1. In order for chaos to occur, the slope of that orbit should be bigger than 1. So chaos cannot occur, but various types of periodic orbits can occur in this range. It will be something like this. It is again a period adding cascade, but with some overlap. There's an overlap between period 1 and period 2, there's an overlap between period 2 and period 3, there's an overlap between period 3 and period 4, and so on and so forth. Again, we'll have more to say about this kind of period adding cascades in future lectures. How much time?
I have.
Okay, so now consider a situation where A is less than 1, but B is greater than minus 1. Clearly, this is stable, no problem. Clearly, this is stable, but this is unstable. Still, there is no problem because this is stable. What about here? This is now unstable. The fixed point is unstable. But will there be any chaotic orbit? Will there be any orbit? Yes, because a trapping region will exist. Notice that this point will map to this, will map to this, will map to that, and it will again, go this way into that. So there is a trapping region that will exist. And depending on the product of the two slopes, various periodic orbits or chaotic orbit may be stable. So it's like this. The bifurcation diagram would be something like this. These are the range where there are various periodic orbits, and then it becomes chaotic. The condition where the slope is negative, but the same situation, where this is stable, this is unstable, here there's no fixed point, But in this case, will there be any chaotic orbit? Yes, there can be. Again, there can be a trapping region in this case. There can be trapping regions in this case. So the behavior will be, in this case, a period 1 to various types of... So the difference is that, in this case, we have shown that it is period 1 to period 3. In this case, you can see something like this. A sudden jump at this point to a period 3 orbit. Okay, that is the distinction between a continuous case and a discontinuous case. And whenever you come across a behavior something like this, then you know that you are dealing with a discontinuous map, a physical system, which, if properly modeled, will give rise to a discontinuous map. In this case, both the slopes are bigger than 1, and in this case, no attractor can really exist. In negative discontinuity situation, see, here is a discontinuity positive. Now, here I consider a negative discontinuity, but both the slopes are bigger than 1. Will there be any orbit? Yes, there can be. And that is what you need to notice. This is what I'm trying to impress upon you. In this case, there can be no stable behavior. But anything that is in this side will go out. Anything in this side will also go out. But here, anything in this side will go out, all right. Anything in this side will go out, all right. But anything in this side will be thrown to this side. Anything in this side will be thrown to that side. But this trapping region will be violated if this point maps to a point beyond R star, and this point maps to a point beyond L star, and that will give the condition of existence of this one. So chaos will exist, only chaos, because these both slopes are bigger than 1. So there would be only chaos, no periodic behavior is possible, and the chaotic behavior is possible only in a certain range. The bifurcation diagram is surprising. You will not come across very often. It's like this. It's only within a certain range a very neat chaotic behavior develops. In this case, it is A is greater than 1 and B is between 0 and minus 1. So in this case, there will be no attractor. In this case, there will be a stable behavior, no difficulty. In this case, the stable behavior remains, but this is unstable. So this becomes the basin of attraction of this attractor. In this case, so I'm not showing the bifurcation diagram because that's easy to imagine what it should be. In this case, A is bigger than 1. This is between 0 and minus 1. So in this case, there can be no attractor. In this case, there can be what? Can you tell me? In this case, this is unstable. So any initial condition in this side will go to infinity, but any initial condition in that side will be thrown to this side, and it may circulate. So there can be a trapping region in this case. It's possible to have a trapping region. The trapping region will not happen if this point maps to a point which again maps to beyond this. Then the trapping region will disappear. And this allows us to obtain a range when this is stable. In this case, there are two possibilities. Either the period 2 orbit is stable or period 2 orbit is unstable. Period 2 orbit is stable in this case. So when it is stable, you have a behavior something like this, a period adding cascade with some overlaps leading to chaotic behavior and disappearing at a certain value of the parameter as anticipated by that condition. Or it can be throughout a chaotic behavior that develops, again disappears at a certain condition. Again, this condition you should be able to, on the basis of what I have already said, you should be able to yourself work out what will happen. No attractor, obviously. There's no fixed point, there's no attractor. In this case, there's unstable fixed point, but still a trapping region may exist. In this case, this is unstable, but a trapping region may exist in between. So in this case, definitely there can be a trapping region, and you can easily work out by the same logic under what condition the trapping region will disappear. Tell me what? This point should map to a point that is beyond the L star. that gives you this condition. For a negative discontinuity, again, in this case, a trapping region may exist. In this case, also a trapping region may exist. So in these cases, a nothing may lead to a chaotic behavior or a periodic behavior like this. So from no attractor suddenly goes into a chaotic attractor with a large expanse, that's possible in this case. In this case, both are negative but less than one. This will be stable, this will be stable, both are stable. So this is rather simple, trivial situation. So I'll not spend much time on that. Only thing is that, can you work out the basin of attraction? This one will have a basin of attraction where, and this one will have a basin of attraction where. I leave it to you to work out what will be the range in which the basin of attraction will lie. By the kind of logic that I have already enumerated a few times, you should be able to work that out. In this case, the discontinuity negative, but both are negative and less than one. So when this one exists, it is stable. When this one exists, it is stable. Then there is no fixed point exists, but again, there would be a possibility of cyclic orbits. So period 2 can be stable, or higher periodic orbits can be stable. And you can, or period 2 orbit can be stable, really. This is the possibility. Since AB product is less than 1, AB individually less than 1, so AB product is less than 1, therefore period 2 is always stable. So you see that the period 2 is always stable, but period 1 is stable only in this part and in this part, not in this part. The thing that you really need to remember are not these individual cases or what are the results. What we really go back with are this kind of bifurcation diagrams. And whenever in our work we come across that kind of a bifurcation diagram, then a light bulb lights. Say that, okay, I've seen that. So the behavior must be resulting from that kind of a situation. If A is negative but smaller than 1, and B is negative but bigger than 1, then this side it is stable for this condition. In this case, this is stable, but this is unstable. And in this case, this is unstable, but there can be a hyperiodic orbit trapping region in this case also. By now, you should be able to figure that out, that there would be a condition under which it will be stable. So in this case, there can be a hyperiodic orbit or a chaotic orbit. So the behavior would be something like this. By the way, depending on the values of A and B, these orbits can be different orbits. It could be period 5, period 7, or it can be a cascade of different periodicities leading to chaos. All these are possible. Only thing is that there is a range over which period 1 will be existing, and then suddenly this will disappear, and certain higher periodic orbits or chaotic orbits will part in here. And finally, in this case, if the discontinuity is negative, then in this case it is stable, in this case it is unstable, and in this case, there is no fixed point. In that case, there is still a possibility of a period 2 behavior, provided AB is smaller than 1, because now this side is smaller than 1, this side is bigger than 1, so the product is not given that it will be smaller than 1. If it is smaller than 1, a period 2 orbit will exist, else it will not. And if it is both are negative and bigger than 1, this is unstable. This is unstable. All these are unstable. But then there can be a trapping region. You can easily see that there can be a trapping region. And if there is a trapping region, it must be chaotic because the slopes are both bigger than 1. So all products of A and B should be leading to values that are bigger than 1. So in that case, whatever happens, if there's a trapping region, the orbit must be chaotic. And the trapping region would occur, again, by the same kind of logic that I already showed. You can calculate the trapping region will be occurring for this. So in each case, it will be instructive for you. If you ever come across a situation like this in your system, it will be instructive to work out the the condition under which chaos occurs, at the same time, what will be the basin of attraction of the chaotic orbit. Basin of attraction is calculated by where this point map, from there you can calculate. And in this case, the bifurcation diagram looks like this. Okay. More or less, we are done, I suppose. Yeah, and the negative discontinuity case. In this case, no attractor can exist because this is unstable, but there cannot be any trapping region in this case. So, we are done. Effectively, what I have tried to convey to you is that if the map is non-smooth and continuous, then certain things are expected to happen. If the map is non-smooth and discontinuous, then certain other things are expected to happen. Whenever you listen to any talk or a class, you do not have to remember everything that was said. All that you are required to go back with is the line of logic used and some impression about what kind of behaviors are expected in what kind of systems. For example, a behavior like this is possible in a piecewise smooth map, but continuous. This kind of behavior is possible in a piecewise smooth map, but discontinuous. Now, we had used a piecewise linear approximation of the piecewise smooth map in order to obtain all this. What can happen in an original map? What will actually be seen are not exactly like that. What actually can be seen would be maybe something like this. There's no reason to believe that these lines will be straight lines in the actual map. When we say that it goes to infinity, no attractor exists, then also it is possible that those lines will bend. Those lines will bend and will lead to a slope that is less than one so that the attractor, the orbit cannot escape. Which means that locally there may not be any orbit, but globally there can still be. Okay? So there can be a non-local orbit. All these are very local analysis of the bifurcation that I've done, which means that locally, in the neighborhood of the bifurcation point, the behavior will be like this. But as you go away from the bifurcation point, it can be slightly different, for example, like this. So whenever I said that it goes to infinity, it may not go to infinity. It may go to some other range of the phase space, that's all. It may discontinuously move to some other range of the phase space. So from this, all I wanted to convey is that in case of a non-smooth system, if it leads to one-dimensional behavior, then that can be all, this is all that can happen. I have actually dealt with all the possible cases. What I have not dealt with is that in some situations we have come across rather complicated bifurcation diagrams, like here. See, very high periodic orbits exist. And if you need to calculate which periodic orbit will exist in which parameter range, that may become nightmarish. But it's possible to calculate that, and that is something that we'll take up in one of the later lectures. Okay. Tomorrow I will deal with two-dimensional maps, that is more general, more important to handle, and that leads to various behaviors that are not observed in 1D. So these are completely new kinds of behaviors will be seen in two-dimensional maps. So tomorrow I'll deal with that. I'm not intending to go into that today. So today, let us stop here. If you have any questions, please ask. are virtual fixed points. Notice that this point, this line, is not meeting the 45 degree line. This line is actually supposed to meet it somewhere here. Therefore, the R star is virtual. But when, let us go to a situation where it is converging onto something, then it will be easier for me to explain. Yeah. In this case, extended this way, it meets here. So this is the fixed point that is supposed to happen, but it's a virtual. Extended this way, it is looking at this. So when an initial condition here, it does not know that after this there is a discontinuity and different map. So it sees that I have to follow this. So any initial condition here in this part actually tries to converge onto what? Converge onto the virtual fixed point. Any fixed point in this part tries to converge onto the virtual fixed point. And that is why these two virtual fixed points become sort of organizing centers of the behavior. For 1D map, you can do without considering that specifically. But in a two-dimensional map, you will see tomorrow that it's very difficult to do anything without understanding the behavior of the virtual fixed point. So in the 2D case, what will happen is that there is one compartment, there is another compartment. If you are in this compartment, the virtual fixed point is sitting there. If you're in this compartment, the virtual fixed point is sitting there. So long as the initial condition is here, it is trying to go there. So long as the initial condition is there, it's trying to go there. Right? And that will organize the dynamics. Therefore, the role of the virtual fixed point becomes very important to understand. Without that, calculating things becomes difficult. Okay. Any other question? Yes. All of these will be seen in two dimensions, but something more will be seen. For example, quasi periodicity cannot be seen in 1D map, can be seen in 2D maps. There are various other behaviors that cannot be seen in 1D map, can be seen in 2D maps. Which I'll come to. Any other question? Okay, let's stop here.